I am so honored and humbled to be able to introduce to you one of the most influential young women on the planet. She is, without a doubt, one of the premier examples of what is possible when power, passion, and performance come together. She survived a cruel attack from the Taliban at age 11, and since then she's devoted her life to creating educational opportunities for women around the world. She's the youngest ever Nobel Peace Prize recipient, and we're so thrilled to have her here today. So please join me in giving a warm welcome to Malala Yousafzai.
It was one of the most important and beautiful trip of my life. I waited to go home for such a long time, and it had been more than 5.5 years since I left my home, and we hadn't seen our country, our friends and family for such a long time. So it was good to go there and to put our feet again on that land, to smell that air and to meet our friends and family, to to give lots of hugs and prayers and kisses, and it was a beautiful time. I met all my relatives, and I met my school friends. I also went to my home in Salt Valley, and just to go and see that the people are still there to support you, they stand with you, and that you can go to your home, that you have the right to go to your home. It was just so important for every one of us. And especially for one of my brothers, because he used to think about Pakistan, about his friends in Pakistan every day. It was really good for us and important for us to go and to see our home and to see our friends again.
And I think I heard you say that even the smell of the air was something you had missed.
Oh, definitely. Firstly, living in the UK for such a long time, and you get
rain.
Like 30 degrees centigrade, like a bit hot for a day. That's it, for a day in summer. And I went to Pakistan, and it was beautiful springtime. It was warm, and I also, there's this smell in the air that you can't describe, that you can only feel when you are there. So I would encourage you all to go to Swat Valley, to go to Pakistan. It's beautiful, and it's peaceful as well now, and you'd really enjoy your time there.
And the school that you helped build with your Nobel Peace Prize money, that recently opened.
Yes, so in our home village, so I was born in Swat Valley, and next to it is Shangla. Shangla is where my parents were born, and that is our village. It is completely a mountainous area. There is no higher secondary school for girls there. So we started the school in Shangla because I believe that we have to start from our home, from where I am, and there is no higher education for girls. So we have to begin from there. We started this school in Shangla, and it has started, it has opened, girls are going there, everyone is just so excited, that whole village is excited. And it is going to change that whole area, because it is state-of-the-art school that is not only going to empower women, but also, bring more jobs, bring awareness, help us to fight against poverty, help us to improve the quality of life for both men and women in that region, to improve the quality of life for children there as well. So I think it is the first step, and I'm sure that it will have an impact on that whole region and bring awareness and improve the quality of life there.
That's great. So, of course, you stand for girls' rights to education, but you take it this one very important step further in that education can be an antidote for many of our world's problems. Could you maybe connect the dots for us, since all these people work in higher education?
I don't think, you are amazing and incredible people that you would need any more detail, but let me explain it. Because you are, and I really want to thank you for the work that you are doing, and also making sure that children, especially in higher education, have, you know, access to quality education, but also how to use technology to make it more accessible. So education is important, but educating girls is even more. Because when we educate girls, we can fight against climate change. When girls are educated, they're more likely to have less children. When that way we can also reduce, you know, the population growth at the rate at which it is going right now. It means their family is going to be more healthy, more prosperous. When we educate a girl, we also help that family to tackle poverty. The woman is able to go and get a job and hunt for her family and not rely on just one person, which is usually the husband. It also means that we are able to fight against early child marriages and child labor, because a girl is not just learning in school, but she's also getting security and safety in that school. So school is also a safe place for girls to protect herself from all these difficulties that she is facing in society. So in education, again, when you educate these women, they're part of the country's resources. They also help to contribute to the economy of the country. And so the advantages are many, and I'm sure that you all know this, and you even know more than that. But we have to keep on reminding our leaders or politicians that this is not just educating one individual girl, but it is also benefiting and impacting the society that we want to improve. So we must invest in girls' education.
So Malala, your story has become bigger than life now. But I'm curious how your friends at Oxford would describe you.
Oh, I never asked them.
How do you think they?
I shouldn't say exactly how. Let me think about how they would describe me in good ways. I think, to be honest, I was really worried when I was going to Oxford, and I struggled a bit at school as well, because I was, you know, defined as the girl who stood up against the Taliban and then winning the Nobel Peace Prize, and just having this definition that you have got from outside. And then you go to school and you just want to be known as, you know, a friend, just Malala, your friend, your class fellow. And so, but it got better with time. And university, it is even better than that. In college, like, everyone has welcomed me as a friend, as a fellow, as a student, and we have, you know, amazing time together. We go to lectures together, go to tutorials together, study, go to library, and you know, go to these events, talks, and have fun. So it is a really beautiful and important part of my life. I'm learning a lot. It is also the first time that I have been, you know, away from my home.
I was wondering if you were living.
I'm living in dorm in the college, and my parents were initially a bit worried, which is normal, I think. They were worried, you know, how are you going to live on your own, and how are you going to cook, and all these things. And I said, don't worry, everything is going to be fine. So they're really happy now for me, and but they're only like 1.5 hour away. So
okay, that's good. You mentioned having fun. So I have 3 kids that are kind of around your age. They're 25, 22, and 19. So I see on Snapchat and Instagram that they do have fun. Yes. But I'm curious, how are you able to have some fun while you're at Oxford, all these pressures on you?
I think it's just spending time with your friends and meeting the people, including inspirational people. So Oxford has Oxford Union, in which you get to hear these incredible people from all over the world, including, like, you know, senators and politicians from the US to the UK, and then inspirational women leaders from all around the world who are doing amazing and incredible work. And so you get to hear that, but you also have your friends who are, like, I think almost every student who I have met in Oxford is doing something great, whether that is, you know, raising awareness or interested in technology or something. So they're all amazing and incredible, and they are clever, they are intelligent, and it is amazing time that you are in a group all these amazing people around you, and you get to learn. But also, you know, you go to a restaurant, you know, have food together, go to balls, and enjoy time.
But it sounds to me you have fun and get joy out of learning itself.
You can't tell everything, you know. Yeah. I'll just only mention nice things.
That's probably wise. What's been your favorite class so far?
I like philosophy, so I study PPE, which is philosophy, politics, and economics. I'd say economics is the hardest, and so I like philosophy.
Yeah. And any big lesson you've gotten out of a class yet from some of these folks?
That I haven't done well, or?
No. I mean an insight, like an aha.
So I did maths at my A-levels, and I said I had said goodbye to maths. And in fact, not, because maths is literally everywhere. They even have maths in politics, and so I was a bit disappointed, you know, to say, like, maths is everywhere. And you're never going to get rid of maths. So, but also I think the approach towards learning, in Pakistan, usually when I was learning there, the system was that you would be taught something and you would memorize it, and you could not question what you were learning, and you could not really give your own opinion. And I think it is it's a completely different approach to our studies in Oxford, and I'm sure in all the Western universities, and I'm sure it's changing in other parts of the world as well. And the approach is that you analyze things, you evaluate them, you question, you have your own opinion, and they encourage you to have your own opinion. And I think it is a great thing, and I don't take it for granted, because I know what I know the importance of it. It encourages you to think, to have, you know, to question things, and to develop your own ideas as well. So I really appreciate that.
That's great. So over the years, have your role models started to shift? Who are your role models, and why?
I would say my first role model is my father, and I say that because he is not just he believes in women, and he believes in women's rights. And some people only say it verbally, but he has actually done it practically. And when I was born, some people came to our family and told my mother that, you know, don't worry, next time you will have a boy. And my father was the one who was so happy to have daughter. He was so happy, he named me after the Malala of my one, an Afghan hero who raised her voice to the soldiers in this battle against the British. And her voice was so powerful that it encouraged the soldiers to fight back and win that battle. And my father had this vision that he would name his daughter after a woman in our Pashtun history who was known by her own name. Usually we don't know any women, we don't know women by their names, we don't even have many women heroes. So he had that vision in his mind. He actually believed in women's rights, and when his cousin brought the family tree of our family, and it was all, you know, full of men's names, no woman was mentioned. And at that time only I was in my father's family, and my dad wrote my name, and my cousin, you know, just kind of laughed and like, what's this man doing, you know, crazy person. And but I think he actually took steps, bold steps, bold feminist steps, and he proved that women deserve equal rights. He admitted me to school, he gave equal and same rights to me and my brothers, he allowed me to learn, and then he allowed me to speak out. People often ask me that, you know, what was in my story, what was in me that allowed me to speak out during the time of Talibanization. And I tell people that I did not have anything special. It was just that my father allowed me to speak. And you know, my father says that, don't ask me what I did, but ask me what I did not do. And I did not clip the wings of my daughter.
So he was your wind beneath your wings.
So he allowed me to fly.
Allowing you to fly. And I'm hoping maybe you could say a little more. I think all the people in this room, we want to always stand up for what's right and find that courage and that strength. Can you help us a little bit with some other notions of where that strength comes from?
I think, so we were living a very beautiful life in Swat. And there were challenges. Women also had challenges in their lives. many girls were not given the right to education. Even my own, like my mother, she could not get her education. She sold her books when she was only six, got her candies in return, and no one even asked about her life, about her education and what she wanted to do, because, you know, they think as soon as she turns 16, 17, they should get married and that's it. So the future of a woman is, you know, growing up and getting married and then having children. And so there were challenges in our region, but we had a peaceful life. Swat was known to be the most beautiful place. It's usually called the Switzerland of the East, but I think it's even more beautiful than that. And we used to have tourists from all across the world. But then suddenly when I was 10 years old, things started changing and these extremist ideas started spreading. And these people started coming to our region and they spread this message of Islam, which was, you know, their own personal interest, that women should not be allowed to go to markets, girls are not allowed to get education, there should not be, you know, any Western education, which they call Western, and they were against the freedom and against the liberty of people. They did not accept people's decisions, people's opinions, and they wanted people to have, you know, same dress code, have same opinions, have follow what they say, and I think it's completely unacceptable because of that I have started valuing and respecting freedom, respecting liberty, respecting people's rights, and it was that situation that motivated me to speak out. And I still remember that day, it was the 15th of January 2009, when the Taliban had given the deadline that after this day no girl is allowed to go to school. And I woke up that morning and I cried. I cried and I realized that I cannot go to school anymore. And the dreams that I had, that I want to become a doctor, you know, one day I'll be standing on my own 2 feet, earning for myself, earning for my family, and I can make decisions on my own, and no one else would be making decisions for me. And I thought that not going to school, I'm just losing that opportunity. Because when I don't go to school, ultimately I'll get married, my husband will be making decisions, and I would only be a mother, a grandmother, and never be a woman. And I think the problem is that you can still be a wife, you can still be a mama, but the main point is that you lose, that it is not your choice, it is not your first choice. And I think whatever decision that girls make, even if it's getting married or whatever, I think it should be their own choice and not implemented upon them by anyone else in their community. So that is why we started speaking out. If we didn't speak out, we would have lived in that situation for the rest of our lives. Right. So speaking out was important for us.
So what do you tell yourself even these today when you're scared? Not that you're scared today, but
when I'm scared of my essays, and when I'm scared of my, you know, not finishing it before the deadline, then I tell myself, Malala, get up and do it. I think I have, when you see the worst of all evils in your life, then I don't think you are scared of anything else. And I think when I was attacked, the intention was to silence this family, not just me, but also my father. The intention was that this family would never say a word again. And that was a big mistake that they made. Because I saw death so close. So close. And I realized that even this death is in support of me and my cause. It doesn't want me too early. And wants me to continue speaking out. And I think it was the prayers of people, it was the support of people from all around the world, and you know, the blessings of God that I survived that egg, I'm here speaking again, and not just in one region, in Swat Valley or in Pakistan, but I'm speaking for girls all across the world. There are more than 130 million girls right now who do not have access to education, and I'm so grateful that I can speak out for them, and I'm hopeful that other people will join me in this cause to ensure that all these girls can have access to safe and quality education.
Personal to me. So I felt like over the years as a 5-foot-tall female with a kind personality that maybe I'm underestimated at times. I know we both got our high heels on. She asked me maybe to put the flats on. So any advice for me or women like me on, because you're so strong and a force to be reckoned with, so no one on this planet thinks of you as a 5-foot-tall 20-year-old.
Yes, there is the height issue.
Yeah.
We do rely on these high heels, and we were discussing this backstage, and we said, like, we don't understand why tall women wear high heels.
I know, it's me.
There's a reason you wear high heels, because you're short. Anyway, that's another time we'll discuss.
Okay.
I think talking about women and I think when we talk about, you know, when I talk about girls' education, and we mention usually the developing countries, Pakistan, India, countries in Africa, even Latin America, and there is this misconception in this that women in the West are fine, they have got everything, they've got, you know, equal rights, education and everything. And I think this is a misconception that needs to be clarified, to say that women still face challenges. Challenges in terms of unequal pay, challenges in terms of not getting the opportunities to get high roles in high positions, whether it's in businesses or in politics or in leadership, and also that women even face sexual harassment that no one even can speak about, or this idea that, you know, women would stay quiet and not speak. And I think right now, just seeing this movement building up and women speaking and raising their voice gives me hope. And I think gives hope to each and every one of us, that women are realizing that things won't change if they don't speak out. So speaking out is important. But also, I think what disappoints me is how we are, you know, defined in terms of from TV to movies to magazines, and wherever we see women are defined, you know, you dress this way, you talk this way, you act this way. And I think we have to challenge that. Whatever we do, even if we follow that code or if we follow a different one, it should be our decision. If I want to wear high heels, it should be my decision. If I want to dress in a certain way, it should be my decision. And women should not feel, you know, there's a certain code that they have to follow. And I keep on, you know, reminding myself that it is, you know, my body, my choice, how I want to talk, how I want to dress, how I want to walk. So that's a reminder to all women and young girls out there. Don't worry about anything. Focus on your dreams, focus on your mission. Don't think about, you know, how you look and how and these things every day. Be focused on how you want to see yourself now and in the coming years.
Be who you are.
Be who you are.
So this community and this audience, we talk a lot about student success. I'm curious if you could tell me how you might define student success, because people have different definitions in their minds.
I think this was completely depend on, you know, how we define success personally,
exactly,
individually.
Yeah.
And to me, I think it's finding yourself and finding what you are passionate about, what you love. And even like when I was doing my